As well. And we're recording it as well. So, okay, so I wanted just to start off with our bio here. This is the Immokalee Workers and the Alliance for Fair Food. Lionel is here with us today, Lionel Perez, and he's been a key leader for an award-winning human rights organization called the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, CIW for short. He's been working with them for over a decade. Mr. Perez worked for years in the field of Florida and along the East Coast, harvesting tomatoes, watermelons, and other crops. Today, as a part of the Fair Food Program, Mr. Perez and his colleagues educate tens of thousands of farm workers on their rights in the fields and on farms participating in the program, including the right to work free of slavery, sexual violence, and health and safety risks. Mr. Perez also hosts shows on the CIW's community radio station and community communications. And throughout the year, he facilitates and conducts dozens of popular education training for weekly membership meetings. Finally, Mr. Perez represents the CIW at a national level, speaking publicly on the challenges faced by farm workers in Florida, both during major actions with thousands of consumers and in dozens of presentations throughout the year. He has been featured in publications such as CNN's Freedom Project and a best-selling books such as Tomato Land. Thank you, Lionel and Marley, for being here with us today.
Thank you, it's our pleasure.
Mm-hmm. Bueno. Soy Leo, bueno, y gracias por esta oportunidad y queremos compartir qué es lo que hacemos, quiénes somos y qué lo hemos logrado y qué queremos lograr todavía.
So good morning, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Leo. It's a pleasure to be here. And we want to start and by presenting a little bit more about who we are as an organization, some of our history, what we've been able to accomplish up until this point, and what we still look to win in the future.
Y somos la organización de trabajadores de Immokalee, la coalición de trabajadores de Immokalee, una comunidad que está basada aquí en el sureste de la Florida. La comunidad se llama Immokalee.
So we're the Coalition of Immokalee Workers, as you stated. We're based in a small farm worker town here in southwest Florida called Immokalee.
Una comunidad que viven temporalmente aquí, simplemente de septiembre a mayo, que es lo que es la cosecha o cultivos de tomate y otros vegetales.
So we are a migrant worker town. So the majority of the community is only here part of the year, usually from about September until May, when the harvest of things like tomatoes and peppers and other products is happening here.
Y la comunidad se mude en diferentes estados siguiendo la cosecha. Otros regresan a México o a Centroamérica. Y siempre trabajadores vienen o nuevos aquí en nuestra comunidad.
And so during, when the harvest is over, some workers will go up north to other states, others will return to Mexico or their home countries in Central America, other places, and then return here once the harvest starts again.
Y nuestra organización está basado aquí, básicamente la base comunitaria de trabajadores del campo, donde nace desde 1993.
And so our organization is really at the heart of the community here in Immokalee and was founded in the early 90s, in around 1993.
La organización nace hablando con trabajadores mexicanos, haitianos y centroamericanos que recibían los mismos abusos que había en la comunidad, en el trabajo o en cualquier parte que enfrentaban, hasta en la tienda a veces.
And our community arose from a series of conversations that was underway with Mexican workers, Haitian workers, Central American workers, all of whom were facing the same abuses and problems at work, you know, all over town at work and even in the stores.
Y en ese tiempo, seis trabajadores empezaron a hablar entre ellos, organizar. Y también gracias con el apoyo de la iglesia católica, la iglesia local aquí, donde emprestaron como un cuarto para que los trabajadores pudieran hablar y organizarse y tener sus reuniones comunitarias.
And so this all started with just a group of six workers who were talking about these issues. And it was in large part thanks to the support of our local Catholic congregation, who allowed those workers to use one of their rooms to meet on a regular basis in order to talk about the issues that they were facing.
Y era una gran necesidad que había, que los trabajadores ya no aguantaban diferentes tipos de abusos, básicamente laborales, en cuestión de lo que se dedicaban los trabajadores, en la pizca o en otros vegetales, que no había ni un control ni derechos para nadie.
And the need for the organization was great indeed because of the incredible amount of human rights abuses and labor rights abuses that workers were facing on a regular basis. The reality was there was no, it was out of control, the situation that workers were facing, and something needed to change.
En Imokali, la mayoría madrugan para ir a buscar un trabajo, por ejemplo. Se levantan a las 5 de la mañana y no sabes si te van a dar trabajo porque empieza desde el parque aéreo donde buscas lo que es la discriminación, los que trabajadores más rápido te llevan o trabajadores que no hablan te llevan y con edad van eliminando a trabajadores sin ningún control.
And so for just to give you a sense of the life of workers here, a lot of farm workers, especially in that time, would get up really early in the hopes of finding work for that day. You would never know if you were guaranteed to actually find work that day. So you'd get up at 5 a.m. and go and start looking for work. But often you would confront issues of discrimination. For example, you know, only the fastest pickers would be selected to go that day. And as you got older or had any other issues, you would be discarded with time.
Donde si encuentras trabajo, llegas en el lugar del trabajo, básicamente trabajadores empiezan a recibir diferentes tipos de abusos.
And so the, you know, what we realized through those conversations that workers were experiencing a whole range of types of abuses.
En los 90s, donde trabajadores, en casos que hemos escuchado, empezaban a trabajar cuando los patrones disparaban, cuando ellos intimidaban a la gente para trabajar muy rápido, como llevaban, podían portar armas en el lugar del trabajo.
So for example, workers would start to work, but under the threat of the use of arms and violence. And so, for example, it was perfectly acceptable to have a gun in the fields to intimidate workers, to push them to work even faster or harder.
En casos donde trabajadores son golpeados, simplemente por ir a tomar agua, por ejemplo.
There were situations in which workers were beaten badly just for simply going to get a drink of water.
Y esos casos no hay ninguna manera donde los trabajadores podían ir y decir lo que pasa. Simplemente si van con la policía, los patrones pagan o contratistas pagan su multa y siguen haciendo. Y era un mensaje que tenían en la labor. Yo te voy a pegar, voy a pagar mi multa y te vuelvo a pegar otra vez.
And unfortunately, there were no consequences for that kind of behavior. You know, even if a beating like that was reported, reality is the crew leaders would just pay the fine if they were fined at all and go back to the same thing. And it was even, you know, a common message and saying it there in the fields. You know, the boss would say, I can beat you and go and pay my fine and then go back and beat you again the next day.
Entonces, no se miraba un fin de la violencia en el lugar del trabajo.
So it felt like there was never going to be an end to the violence that workers were facing in the fields.
Podían robar salario a los trabajadores cuando quieran, y los trabajadores no podían exigirle porque también son amenazados.
You know, they could, in other cases, they could just, you know, keep workers' wages and not pay them fully, and workers wouldn't say anything because they felt threatened.
En el salario, por ejemplo, trabajadores recibían de 40 centavos por una cubeta de 32 libras de tomate.
And in those days, the wages were incredibly low. For a bucket of 32 pounds of tomatoes, you would only get about 40 cents.
Por ejemplo, tienes que hacer 100 cubetas de tomate de 32 libras para ganar tus $40 o menos.
And so you would have to pick... you would have to pick 2.5 tons of tomatoes in a day just to be able to make minimum wage.
Y por otro lado, los abusos contra las mujeres, habían acoso sexual y no había ninguna manera como detenerlos. Seguían pasando, muchas mujeres dejaban el trabajo, se iban, igual hombres salían del trabajo, pero siempre habían quien llegaba a trabajar.
And then also there were issues of sexual harassment and abuse in the field. So especially, you know, when women were facing those types of abuses, you know, the most they could do was leave the job. But there was always, you know, whether men and women for that matter, who would leave, you know, maybe they would leave the job that was abusive, but there would always be someone to replace them.
Y casos más extremos, pues llegaban, cuando existen todos estos tipos de abusos, llegaban en casos de más extremos, por ejemplo, de esclavitud moderna.
And in the most extreme cases, these situations would rise to the level of something like modern day slavery.
Caso, por ejemplo, caso Navarrete, un caso que pasó aquí en la comunidad a unas 3-4 cuadras de nuestra oficina, donde docenas de trabajadores fueron reclutados, trabajaban en la industria de tomate, son llevados a otros estados también.
So just to give a few examples of what that looks like, there was the Navarrete case, which happened right here in Immokalee, just 3 or 4 blocks from our office, in which workers had been recruited to work, and they were taken to work, forced to work without pay, not only here, but also were taken up north and back as well.
Donde trabajadores son llevados al norte, pero ya cuando llegaban allá, ya les cobraban lo que es el raite, la vivienda, le cobraban comida. Entonces, cuando llegaban en otros estados, ya tenían una deuda encima, donde esa deuda no los dejaba salir y no los dejaba permitir ganar básicamente el salario de los trabajadores.
And, you know, one of the mechanisms is that is, you know, whether they're up here, especially once they got up north, they would be charged for housing, for food, for transportation, for any cost that that a boss could think of. And then in such a way that it would put them in debt, and that at the end of the day, they wouldn't be able to take home any of their wages because of the supposed debt.
Donde regresaban en Immokalee, vivían en una casa, básicamente los dueños son los contratistas, donde trabajadores ya son amenazados y intentan escapar y de ir a trabajar en otro lado.
And when they get back here, the bosses would live in this house and would be keeping workers, you know, basically imprisoned, and the workers would try to escape and would try to go work somewhere else.
Testimonio de trabajadores que ganaban como $20 por semana porque ellos cobraban lo que es la vivienda, lo que mencioné, cobraban todo y los trabajadores seguían trabajando por una supuesta deuda cuando no existe.
And so, you know, again, we heard reports and testimony from workers after that case that they maybe were paid $20 in a whole week because of the bosses, you know, supposedly charging them for, again, things like housing and food and anything. And so they were supposedly working off this debt and forced to stay because of the debt that really didn't exist.
Cuando los contratistas podían controlar los trabajadores, se iba más extremo las condiciones que vivían los trabajadores.
And with that level of control over workers, the conditions in which they were living became more and more extreme over time.
Y ya los trabajadores vivían en un camión de trabajo donde ahí se quedaban y los encerraban para que no salieran.
For example, the workers were forced to live in the back of a box truck, basically a big empty work truck. And at nighttime, they were closed in there and not allowed to leave.
Y hasta hubo un momento donde los trabajadores se opusieron y uno de ellos, pues, los amarraron con una cadena para que no intentaban escaparse.
And there was even a moment at which one of the workers, you know, tried to push back and fight back, and so they ended up chaining his wrists inside the truck.
Y hasta cuando los trabajadores intentaron escapar, se escaparon, llegaron a nuestra oficina de la coalición, simplemente porque escucharon que nosotros trabajamos para eliminar casos de esclavitud, porque tenemos una radio comunitaria. Así llegó la información a los trabajadores, se escaparon Y bueno, también de ahí empieza lo que es la investigación, si es un caso de esclavitud moderna o simplemente no es un caso, pero al final se declaró como un caso de esclavitud moderna y fueron sentenciados también.
And so finally, one of the workers was able to escape from that situation and he came to the office of the CIW because he had heard of our work to try to resolve and find justice for those cases of forced labor. Because we have a community radio station that's able to get the word out to our community about the type of work that we do. And so workers were able to come here and seek help. And that's what started, that touched off a whole investigation process. And that ultimately was declared a case of modern day slavery under federal law. And the bosses in that case were sentenced to prison.
Entonces, casos así fueron llevados a la corte, básicamente 15 años le dieron a los contratistas porque salieron culpables, que fue un caso de esclavitud moderna.
And so in court, those bosses were ultimately sentenced to 15 years in federal prison for having committed forced labor.
Y eso es un caso y hemos visto como 9 casos en los últimos 20 años.
So that's one example of a case, but we've actually helped to investigate and seen 9 cases in the last number of years.
Y esos casos fueron de trabajadores, la mayoría son mexicanos.
And the majority of those workers were Mexican workers.
Y mucha gente ha tenido esa pregunta, porque son trabajadores migrantes que vienen. Y es que la situación no se trata quién cae en este caso. Simplemente si tú no tienes un trabajo, eres pobre, puedes caer en esta situación.
And many people have asked the question, well, you know, perhaps it's because they were Mexican nationals and are immigrants, and that was the vulnerability that led to that situation. But the reality, and this has been illustrated, is that it doesn't matter as much where you come from, but it's simply the vulnerability of if you don't have a job and you are poor and you need work, anybody can fall into that kind of situation.
Donde un caso también de Ron Evans, que esto fue en Palanca, básicamente trabajadores en otros tipos de vegetales, como papa también, que son trabajadores reclutados en diferentes ciudades grandes de aquí.
And so just to give another example that illustrates that was the case of Ron Evans. That was based in Palanca, Florida, in which he recruited U.S. citizens, people from the United States and a number of different urban areas across the state of Florida.
Simplemente eran trabajadores que no tenían una vivienda, que ellos fueron a reclutar en diferentes ciudades como Miami, Tampa, Orlando, y les ofrecieron trabajo, vivienda, y los ofrecieron todo. Cuando tenían un gran grupo de trabajadores, empezaron a explotar esos trabajadores en los ranchos.
And so they would go to these large cities and recruit from the homeless community. So they would go to Miami, to Orlando, to Tampa, and promise these workers, you know, a job and pay and housing. And once they had a large group of workers, they began to exploit them.
Y la estrategia de este señor fue de pagar a trabajadores con alcohol, cigarro, drogas, y les cobraban toda la vivienda. Les vendía comida igual en los ranchos y los trabajadores vivían en casas donde cada noche los encerraban y tenían un guardián para que no salieran.
And so, you know, one of the strategies of Ron Evans, of that boss, was to pay workers with alcohol or with drugs. And then also on top of that, to charge them for, again, housing and food and other supposed costs, and as a result, he was able to control them. And they were living in a labor camp in which, you know, at nighttime they'd be shut in at night and not allowed to leave.
Entonces, trabajadores decían que hasta les quitaban los zapatos, hasta que alguien les pasaba caminando enfrente de la casa con un bate, que nadie intentaba escapar. Y todos los trabajadores tenían una deuda grande con el patrón simplemente por consumir tipos de alcohol.
And so even, you know, the workers would reported later in testimony that they, for example, their shoes would be taken away from them at night, so they would have a harder time running away. You know, and again, that someone would be patrolling the edges of the camp with a bat to make sure that no one was trying to leave. And again, the final form of coercion was this supposed debt that workers were under because of the things that the boss had charged them for.
Forzados a trabajar también de 10 a 12 horas diarias.
And then they'd be forced to work for 10 to 12 hours a day.
Entonces, casos que hemos visto, también esto fue declarado como un caso de esclavitud moderna aquí en Florida.
And just similarly, that case was ultimately prosecuted federally and declared a case of modern day slavery.
Y estos casos no han sido fácil de detectarlos, básicamente, porque los trabajadores primero no quieren hablar. En casos, muchos de los trabajadores son amenazados de muerte y también su familia lo amenazan. Simplemente decir, conozco tu familia, donde vives, y ya los trabajadores no intentan hablar. Muchos de los trabajadores les quitan los teléfonos para que no puedan tener comunicación con otros trabajadores.
And so, you know, many of these workers, it's been incredibly hard to, because of the situation they're in, for us to detect these cases, to investigate these cases. Many workers don't speak up because they themselves are threatened with violence, their families are threatened with violence. You know, it's as simple as saying, I know where your family lives. And that can really cow someone into silence under these circumstances. So it's been incredibly hard to uncover these cases and investigate them.
Mm-hmm. Y estos casos que mencionamos de ejemplo, básicamente son casos como 2010, 2007, 2008, que salieron estos casos.
So these two cases that we've mentioned as examples, came out around 2007, 2008.
Y la coalición ha trabajado mucho sobre eso. Desde el principio hubo como marchas de tener un diálogo con los rancheros, hubo paros laborales, hubo huelga de hambre, por ejemplo, de hecho, una huelga de hambre por 30 días, parte de 6 trabajadores.
And so the CIW's initial, you know, the CIW's worked on these types of cases for many, many years since the very beginning. And many of the early actions were driven by those cases. So the CIW, you know, in order to improve conditions, you know, had hunger strikes and, you know, marched for hundreds of miles calling for change. You know, in fact, one of the earliest actions was a hunger strike of 30 days by a number of workers.
Y eso también donde la Iglesia Católica jugó un papel importante, porque el obispo en ese tiempo en Florida, él intervino para que los trabajadores no siguieran con la huelga, porque los rancheros no iban a venir en la mesa.
And in fact, during that action, in particular, the Catholic Church played an incredibly important role. The bishop at that time here in Florida, for our area, intervened because the growers, the bosses of the farms were not coming to the table, were not going to make change. And so the bishop was the one who intervened and called for the workers to break their hunger strike out of care for them.
Y pues la organización siguió intentando cómo eliminar estos tipos de casos, cómo dejar que sigan los trabajadores así públicamente explotados y nadie lo hacía nada. Hicimos contra los rancheros, no se pudo.
And so the CIW continued to ask this question, how can we bring an end to these types of abuses? How can we ensure that workers no longer face these things? And so bringing these actions directly against the growers for many years simply wasn't working.
Y de ahí nace la idea de una campaña por comida justa, donde entramos a pedir directamente a los compradores.
And so that's where this idea came for a campaign for fair food. And that's where we would go directly to the major buyers of produce at the top of the supply chain.
Porque vimos que en los casos de esclavitud, los que fueron sentenciados son los contratistas, pero ninguna de las compañías de la industria de tomate fue castigado. Ellos siguieron vendiendo, ellos siguieron trabajando, sacando su ganancia.
Because something that we notice is that in each of these cases of slavery, yes, the direct bosses were sentenced to prison, but the farms on which those tomatoes were being harvested under duress faced no consequences and continued to sell their product without issue.
Entonces vimos que los grandes compradores tenían un papel muy importante sobre la industria agrícola. porque sus demandas esfuerzan a los trabajadores a trabajar más, donde vimos que ellos compraban tomate barato porque compraban año redondo y por millones de libras de tomate por mayoreo.
And so we did an analysis and saw that those buyers really had an incredible amount of responsibility. You know, these buyers would, it's really their pressure on the market that helps to create these kinds of exploitative conditions, especially as time went on and these buyers were purchasing at incredibly low prices because they could purchase in volume. So they purchased, you know, millions of tons of tomatoes every year and year round, and were able to negotiate a very low price for that, putting pressure on workers at the bottom.
Entonces nace la campaña por comida justa, dirigida básicamente a todos los compradores, pero específicamente a John Brands o a Taco Bell, donde se explica, donde ellos compran tomate en Florida. Esas son las condiciones de los trabajadores, de lo que ya hablé, y cómo ellos pueden involucrarse y eliminar estos tipos de abusos.
And so that's where the campaign for fair food was born, and specifically The first campaign was with Yum Brands, which is the parent company of Taco Bell. And it was saying, you know, the workers in your supply chain are laboring under these types of abuses, and that needs to change.
Y las cosas que pedíamos es que paguen un centavo por cada libra de tomate que compran y que vaya directamente a los trabajadores. Que comprometen comprar tomate donde los rancheros respeten los derechos de los trabajadores. Y crear un código, crear varios derechos. Y otra parte, que los trabajadores tengan una voz dentro de la industria agrícola donde pueden reclamar sus derechos, donde pueden poner una queja y no van a ser amenazados. Entonces, de ahí son los tres puntos que pedíamos a Taco Bell.
And so, and from the very beginning, we established the three core demands of our campaign. So the first was that these major corporations, these buyers, paid an extra penny per pound, and that that money would go to alleviate the economic insecurity of workers in the form of additional wages and the form of a bonus. Second, that those buyers would direct their purchases only to farms where workers' rights were actually being respected, that there would be a code of conduct created that would ensure certain rights were being implemented in the fields. And third, that workers had a voice in the agricultural industry and that they had a way to put in a complaint and to speak up when their rights were being violated and to actually have a solution. So those were the three main points of our campaign with Taco Bell at the very beginning.
Y para que Taco Bell pueda escuchar a los trabajadores, involucramos directamente consumidores. Llevamos esta campaña en diferentes universidades, iglesias que mandaban carta a Taco Bell. Los estudiantes empezaron a boicotear a Taco Bell hasta cuando Taco Bell vio que los consumidores querían un cambio en su cadena. Ellos vinieron a los 5 años, firmaron un acuerdo con la coalición y esto fue el primer acuerdo del 2005.
And so based on those three calls for action, we were able to launch this broader campaign, not just us as farm workers, but together with consumers to send that message to these major buyers. And so we started to partner with communities of faith, with student groups all across the country to send that message to Taco Bell. And so we, you know, we had letter writing campaigns. There were, you know, the students declared a national boycott of Taco Bell in order to send that message to the corporation. And so it was through that consumer message that consumers also wanted change, wanted to see a new industry, that we're able to win our first agreement with Taco Bell, and that was in 2005.
Consumidores entendieron muy rápido la campaña. Voy a consumir este tomate que viene en estas condiciones. No, tengo que demandar a Taco Bell, tengo que hacer algo. Hacían protestas, mandaban cartas y rápido logramos cambiar muchas cosas. Hoy en día son 14 corporaciones que pagan ese centavo y que se comprometen a comprar tomate donde nosotros establecemos nuevos derechos a los trabajadores.
And so it was through that consumer support that we were able to make a lot of change, because consumers very quickly understood the logic of this campaign. Am I as a consumer going to eat a tomato that I know has been harvested under exploitative conditions? No, I am going to join my voice to those of farm workers to call for change. Consumers would go to protests, would write letters and participate in these campaigns. And it was through this partnership and through this campaign that we've been able to affect a great deal of change. Today, we have 14 agreements with some of the largest corporations in the world, and we have who are now paying that extra penny per pound and who are only buying from growers that are ensuring workers' rights. And so we've been able to create the Fair Food Program and that code of conduct and implement it on farms.
Mm-hmm. Por ejemplo, Taco Bell, McDonald's, Burger King, Subway, Chipotle, Walmart, Whole Foods, Trader Joe's, Fresh Market, and Giant in Stop and Shop. Y otros proveedores de comida.
And so, for example, we have major fast food companies like Taco Bell, McDonald's, Burger King. We also have supermarkets like Ahold USA, which includes Giant and Stop and Shop, Trader Joe's, Fresh Market, Whole Walmart. Foods, Walmart, who are all, as well as some food service providers who are all participating in the company, in the program.
Y en el 2010, el 90% de la industria agrícola de Florida, o básicamente la sección de rancheros y vegetales en Florida, llegaron con nosotros. ¿Cómo podemos cambiar esta industria?
And so because of that market pressure, because of those agreements that we had with buyers in 2010, 90% of the Florida tomato growers, namely the Florida Tomato Growers Exchange, came to the CIW and said, okay, we're hearing this from the people who buy our products. What can we do to make a change in this industry?
Y creamos un programa que se llama el programa por comida justa. Tenemos un acuerdo con esos rancheros de que esto ahora, los derechos de los trabajadores tienen es decir el derecho a tomar agua, tienes tomar derecho de tomar un descanso. No vas a ser despedido simplemente porque ellos quieren. Los trabajadores tienen el derecho de ganar el salario mínimo, pero cero tolerancia de acoso sexual, de discriminación, cero tolerancia de esclavitud moderna, por ejemplo.
And so through that breakthrough agreement with the tomato growers, we were able to finally implement these rights through the creation of the Fair Food Program. And so that code of conduct that's now implemented on those farms ensures everything from workers being able to take a break, to go get water and not be fired or harassed for doing those things. It has zero tolerance for things like sexual assault and forced labor and prohibitions against discrimination. And so now all of those rights are being implemented on the participating farms.
Y eso fue un cambio muy grande, básicamente que ahora los rancheros tienen que respetar todos los derechos de los trabajadores. Si ellos no quieren cumplir, básicamente los 14 corporaciones, quien compra con ellos, no va a seguir comprando. Y esto un cambio grande donde ellos tienen que hacer. Y ahora casi todos los, el 90%, ellos prohíben diferentes protecciones a los trabajadores.
And so that has created a huge change in the industry, because when it comes down to it, if you're a tomato grower and you don't want to comply with those protections, you don't want to implement those new rights, then all of those 14 massive buyers will cut their purchases from you as a grower. And so that has created an environment in which those growers really have to put those protections in place, mm-hmm. and has created a great deal of change in the industry.
Donde elementos importantes del programa por comida justa es de que, como nosotros, parte del staff de la organización, hablamos directamente con los trabajadores en los ranchos, hablamos, esto es tu derecho bajo este programa, aquí en esta compañía. Los trabajadores tienen derecho de hablar y poner una queja donde no son despedidos ni amenazados de hablar y cómo poder cambiar la situación.
And so now under this program, just to talk briefly about how it works, that we do, for example, education on the field. So as part of our work at the CIW and part of an education team, we go and educate workers on their rights. And workers have different options for how to report abuses and have those abuses investigated when they do occur.
donde los trabajadores reciben básicamente entrenamiento de sus derechos, donde los trabajadores tienen también una oportunidad de hablar en su idioma, donde pueden poner una queja y con personas que se sienten más cómodos.
So, and as we explained in our education process, workers have the right to report these issues in the language of their choice, in a number of different languages that people feel most comfortable in to make sure it's accessible.
Donde también tienen el derecho más importante de expresarse libremente en la compañía, donde uno puede decir, yo no me siento cómodo, esto es lo que está haciendo mi compañero, el contratista, el supervisor, y no hay una manera que se pueden enojar y decir, no puedes hablar así, no puedes decir así. Y esas quejas van a ser investigadas hasta que llegar en una consecuencia, ¿quién lo hace? El programa simplemente eliminamos a personas que quieren hacer daño a otros.
And so now, in the event that there's a worker who, is having a bad experience, they can call and say, hey, what this supervisor or this coworker or this crew leader is saying or doing is making me uncomfortable. There's a way to have that investigated there instead of workers facing retaliation. And so having that kind of protection means that workers can now actually find a solution for issues as they arise, rather than having to remain quiet or be told, you can't say that or you can't speak about those things.
Y si la compañía no quiere ceder o cambiar, básicamente entonces viene el poder de Walmart, de McDonald's, decir no vamos a comprar contigo hasta que se arreglan estos problemas. Entonces los rancheros también toman esa decisión, yo no quiero perder mi negocio simplemente porque este contratista sigue abusando.
And so, again, the program is built to get rid of kind of the people who want to do harm and the people who are creating those kind of circumstances. And so once those complaints have been investigated and they arrive at a solution, then the growers really have to implement them, because if they don't want to implement those types of solutions or make the right decision, then again, that's where the power of Walmart and other buyers comes in to say, we can't buy from you until you actually implement these changes and these protections.
Y entonces, de así consiste el programa por comida justa. Se ha cambiado mucho, pero también se ha expandido. Empezamos en Florida, ahora en 8 estados, en Tennessee, Georgia, Virginia, durante la temporada.
Mm-hmm. And so that is, in essence, the Fair Food Program, and we've been able to expand as well. And so now we have operations and different farms across 8 different states in the East Coast, including Tennessee, Georgia, and others. And so we've been able to grow.
Pero en otra parte, las compañías que no están bajo el programa, porque hay muchísimos, existen los casos todavía en otras industrias o directamente en la industria agrícola, existen y siguen pasando y nosotros seguimos investigando esto.
And so at the same time, we know that this is still just the tip of the iceberg. There are still many growers and many industries where the Fair Food Program has not yet been implemented. And so unfortunately, those types of abuses that we discussed are still happening on farms outside of the Fair Food Program, and we as the CIW continue to investigate them.
Hay muchos ejemplos de estas investigaciones nuevos, pero lamentablemente no se pueden compartir porque muchos trabajadores siguen en esta situación y hay casos que tal vez pueden salir pronto.
And so, there are many examples of these situations in which workers are still living under these conditions even as we speak, for example, we still can't share the details about them because those cases are still under investigation and may come to light any day now.
Y bueno, nosotros, nuestra profesión, tenemos mucho de qué hablar, pero también creo que en tiempo que podemos tal vez salen en las preguntas.
And I can just end by adding how people can get involved. As Leah was discussing, we still need to expand the Fair Food Program. And so there is there's an ongoing campaign with Wendy's, which is still the company that has not yet joined the Fair Food Program. So there is a national boycott, and we invite you all to be a part of that. Specifically, this fall, we're going to be going, doing a virtual tour, a virtual series of actions. Specifically, if you're in Columbus, Ohio, New York, or San Francisco, we're asking for assistance in setting up discussions with social justice groups, congregations, organizations, any connections that you all have. We would love the opportunity to educate more communities about these issues and the urgent need for expansion and for change and for companies like Wendy's to take responsibility for the conditions in their supply chain and to join a proven solution like the Fair Food Program. Even if you're not in any of those three cities, we do have a national week of action that we're organizing, and we would love to invite you all to participate. That'll be the 15th through the 21st of November. And I'll put in the chat some websites and also the contact information for the for Uriel, who's the principal organizer, who you can get in touch with if you would like to join the week of action.
O también pueden ir al sitio de la coalición. Tenemos varios lugares donde pueden apoyar con donaciones, con cosas que nosotros tenemos que lidiar para llevar este programa.
And finally, you can always go to the CIW's website. We're always have lots of opportunities there to learn more, to donate, to and to get involved.
Comprar una camisa de estas.
For example, you can get one of these t-shirts.
Great. Thank you guys so much. This was so informative. I'm so excited to see how this is going to change people's behaviors, right? To then to make action happen. Somebody had asked, is there a fair trade logo on produce grown from these specific farms?
Bueno, en verdad ahorita estamos trabajando. Ya algunos están usando, por ejemplo, Whole Foods, Compass Group, ya están usando, pero todavía no hemos llegado en este caso por todo, pero algún día sí lo estamos trabajando.
So we're still working on the question of labeling. So it's different from the Fair Trade label. So there's the Fair Trade USA, which is a totally separate program, kind of apples to oranges, but there is a Fair Food label. We're still in the process of rolling it out. And I know that it is being implemented in some of the participating stores like Whole Foods. You'll be able to find the Fair Food label on their tomatoes, but we're still working on that, on getting it more broadly used. And I can share a couple of links. You can go to the Fair Food Program website to get the full list of participating buyers where you can go and purchase as well and look for that label.
Yeah, that'd be great if you could add that into the chat. So I think that since there isn't a label, what everybody should know is go to one of these supporting stores so that you know that your tomatoes are coming from an organization that supports this, that CIW has worked with. So, shopping at those stores. One of the questions that we have here is, so we've been focusing as an organization, the U.S. Catholic Sisters Against Trafficking, we've been focusing on the connections between the economic system of neoliberal capitalism and human trafficking this year. And we're trying to envision an economy without human trafficking. Leonel, what does that look like to you? An economy without human trafficking, what does that mean to you?
Yeah, como que ellos han estado trabajando en el concepto de una economía como en contra del neoliberalismo, ¿verdad? Como algo que no está construido encima de la esclavitud moderna o trato humana. ¿Cómo se ve una economía justa para ti?
Sí, en cuestión como laborales, por ejemplo, de nuestra campaña, creo que eso, por eso nace nuestra campaña, porque unos tenían una ganancia enorme sobre las condiciones de los trabajadores aquí.
And so, you know, really what we see is, you know, when we're looking for a just economy is respect and dignity for workers who are here.
Por ejemplo, un trabajador gana 40 centavos por una cubeta de 32 libras, 40 centavos. y una tienda por 32 libras puede ganar 70, 80, hasta $100.
And so just the basic principle of how little workers are paid is also something to pay attention to. So like I mentioned, back in the day, workers were paid for 32 pounds of tomatoes. For picking 32 pounds of tomatoes, they'd be paid 40 cents for that bucket. And then in a supermarket, that supermarket might make 60, 70, even $100 for that same 32 pounds.
Y con y por eso nuestra campaña, porque en lugar de pedir a los rancheros, mejor los que tienen más, que ayuden para eliminar básicamente esto.
And so that's part of what we've structured into our campaign is economic justice. So calling for those companies that are making a ton of profit hand over fist to pay their fair share and help to improve the economic security of workers.
That's great. Thank you so much. Somebody wanted to know, is it just the tomatoes and peppers? Or is it in other industries such as a strawberry industry? Someone was asking about Watsonville, California.
Mm-hmm. So it's the program is currently in a number of different, so it's principally in tomatoes. The vast majority is tomatoes. There's also some sweet bell peppers in there and other mixed vegetables. Our farms range from one worker to 1,000 workers. So we have some small mixed vegetable farms, for example, in Homestead, Florida, to some, to massive multi-state farms up and down the coast. We have one very, very small flower farm that has just come on board in California. We're not yet in strawberries either in Florida or in California. There was a brief experimental strawberry farm that was in the program for 2 years, but then stopped planting strawberries. So we're constantly on the verge of expansion into new industries. Most recently, Leo and I actually went up to Virginia to bring in the largest cut flower farm in the East Coast, Blumia. So they were one of the most recent additions to the program, bringing in hundreds of new workers and in a totally different type of industry. But they're very, very excited about being a part of the program and are breaking ground in new products.
Mm-hmm. Y hay otras organizaciones que quieren tomar el modelo, por ejemplo, en Vermont, en lo que es la lechería. Y estamos trabajando para expandir en otras industrias, pero en la lechería creo que es lo único que se ha implementado igualito que aquí.
And the other exciting thing is that not only are we expanding the Fair Food Program, but there's many other groups of workers and organizations that want to take this model and replicate it in other industries. So for example, in the Vermont dairy industry, a different group of workers has actually been able to work with us as mentors kind of and to recreate the Fair Food Program, but in their own industry. And so that's the most mature replication of the model is the Milk with Dignity Program. So we call it the worker-driven social responsibility model, and that can be implemented in different industries. And there's a number of others as well, but the Milk with Dignity is the most mature replication that's in practice.
Mm-hmm. That's exciting. Congratulations on that. Great. One thing that had been brought to my attention was not only as there labor trafficking that has been going on in Immokalee and these various farms, but also sex trafficking. Do you know anything about that or can address that?
I'm happy to take that question. Actually, just as a quick aside, a big part of my job, in addition to having the privilege of getting to accompany colleagues like Leo in presentations, I work a lot on our anti-slavery program and do a lot of work with law enforcement and kind of liaising with different groups for those cases. It's a bit of a Venn diagram. So there are many cases that involve sex trafficking or sexual exploitation that are also labor trafficking. In particular, and one of the topics that I know that we don't have as much time for, but it would be a good thing for folks to look into is the guest worker program, the H-2A program that brings workers over on temporary visas. So for example, there's a case that's underway right now, so I can't share a ton of details, but that involves sex trafficking and labor trafficking. So some workers who have been brought over to work on farms but are also exploited sexually as a form of intimidation, or the CNC case, which was a 2016 case outside of the Fair Food Program, also in Devil's Garden, just 30 miles from here, in which workers were sexually harassed and sexually assaulted in addition to being forced to work in the field. So there is actually some overlap in some of these cases, and not just with women, but also with male workers. And then separately, there are, I mean, the you know, there are certainly many cases that are exclusively sex trafficking. That isn't where we focus. We focus on labor trafficking since we're a farm worker organization, but even in some of our cases, there is some overlap, if that answers your question.
Yes, thank you. What about minors? How have you been seeing any kind of minors being?
En verdad, últimamente no, y menos bajo el programa, pero los últimos casos que yo miraba eran como del 2007, 8 y 10, que habían menores. Y ahorita, bajo el programa, por sí no pueden trabajar a niños. Pero en otras industrias, sí. En otros, aunque no estén bajo el programa, sí, seguro que hay menores de 14, 15 años que están trabajando, porque no hay nadie quien lo regula.
So under the Fair Food Program, one of the zero tolerance policies is child labor. And so we certainly haven't seen any of that, even just working in the fields illegally under the Fair Food Program. And also in some of the forced labor cases, there were maybe a few, you know, kids who were under 18 who were involved in some of the early cases, but they're more like 14, 15, 16. And it's not incredibly common, to tell the truth. It certainly is outside of the Fair Food Program, and generally not necessarily in forced labor cases, but certainly in labor practices in general and agriculture, there's quite a bit of that.
Sí, pero el otro lado también, cuando yo miraba estos casos, los niños decían, mis papás me llevaban porque le ayudaba por llenar unas 10, 20 cubetas y más dinero para la familia los fines de semana. Entonces uno queda, pues, ¿qué puedes hacer en esto? Ves el problema, es el salario.
And so, you know, and just to reflect, one of the things that I would hear from kids who I'd see in the fields, you know, I'd say, well, you know, my parents brought me to the fields with them because I can help by filling, you know, maybe 15 or 20 extra buckets in a day, which helps my family eat more. And so you get to that root problem of poverty and the poverty wages.
Right. Yeah. Thank you so much. I want to really encourage everybody to go to the websites, because you can learn there what to do about this, and taking action is so important. And you know, we sit here thinking, oh, what can I do? I can make sure that the store that I go to or sells, you know, these fair foods, or I can make sure I don't go to Wendy's. But especially if you're from Columbus, Ohio, or one of these other cities, I encourage you to host a night like this. They're going to be coming to our areas. They want to get people out and to learn more about it. There's even going to be a protest here in Columbus, where I'm from, with Wendy's as well. It would make a huge difference to get Wendy's on board with this. And I really encourage you to do that. And absolutely, just have some great action steps on their website as well. So we really encourage that. And we do have another upcoming webinar at the end of September on ethical representation. It's for our members only. So you have to be a member of the U.S. Catholic Sisters Against Human Trafficking. Anybody can be a member. You don't have to be Catholic or a sister. And we highly suggest you become a member of us to get access. Rarely do we do webinars like this that are open to the public. We just really wanted to make sure that everybody had access to this amazing webinar today. But the one at the end of the month is on the imagery and the wording that we use around human trafficking and slavery and best practices. So I just want to thank you guys so much for coming on and educating us on this really, really important issue of slavery in our tomatoes.
Yeah, it's been our pleasure. Thank you so much for this opportunity.
Sí, gracias, y espero que nos pueden apoyar en esto, hablar con más personas, y también muchas veces grupos así crean una carta, firman todos y mandan a Wendy's.
And so you can, you know, we thank you so much. You know, we really appreciate this time. And, you know, again, another thing that even organizations do, so as this network, is write a network letter and have members sign and send that to Wendy's. So There's lots of ways to get involved.
Yeah. Jennifer, do you have anything?
Yeah, I just want to also add my gratitude to Marley and Leo for your wonderful presentation today. Thank you so much for sharing about all of the important work that your organization has done and continues to do. We really look forward to, you know, collaborating and being able to join in these really important campaigns. Solo quiero expresar mis gracias a los dos por su presentación hoy. Han sido muy informativo para todas y espero poder colaborar en esas campañas para poder apoyar el trabajo que están realizando. I also just wanted to add really quick that we are doing another webinar tomorrow in collaboration with Catholic Prison Ministries. Teresa will be presenting along with another survivor advocate that we work with, Chris Wade, on how incarceration intersects with human trafficking. And we certainly see that in a number of different spaces, including like immigration detention centers in local jails and prisons. There's a lot of intersection with human trafficking. So that is also a free and public webinar. You can register through the Catholic Prison Ministries website. I'll put a link in the chat here. For tomorrow. Yes, thanks, Kara. That's the direct link to the registration page. And we hope you all can join us on that webinar as well to learn a little bit more about incarceration and human trafficking.
Thank you all.
Gracias.
Thank you.